wonder kid than he already was.
Geez.
So he lied to make himself younger so people would say he was even more of a genius than he was already considered, isn't
that? Oh, God, how lame.
I know.
Lame ass. Oh, geez, how embarrassing.
I thought that was pitiful.
God. God.
Come on, I'm 12 all over.
Hey, Mark, any luck with the Roseville police?
Nothing. I had to leave a message, but the guy did laugh when I asked
him. Oh, he did. Okay. We're trying to know there's a guy who swallowed a diamond at the jewelry exchange, and they're waiting for him to pass the diamond now so they can arrest him.
Or cut glass with his ass.
I'm hoping that he'll attempt a courtesy flush.
Yeah.
You know, he'll just say, he'll act like, oh, it's crazy.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah,
my God.
Yeah.
That was my idea, but it's a dry dump. He doesn't even, he doesn't even get a normal bowl for this, I guess.
We hear it's a dry bowl, which, God, the stench.
If anybody wants to call in, I bet there's quite a few people who've had to dig something.
You think so?
Well, you know, kids swallow things all the time.
Dogs do.
My brother had a key collection.
Yeah.
He was so into it that he had one of the keys in his mouth.
Yeah.
Of course, he swallows it.
Really? The key?
Yeah, he swallowed a key.
Oh, man.
And everybody was horrified.
Oh, God.
And, you know, doctors, oh, he'll be okay. He'll pass it.
No.
And then a couple days later.
All of a sudden, he'll, like, cut a lock out of his ass. When it's done, it's like, oh, geez, the key fits his a-hole.
A couple days later, my brother's like, look, I got my key back.
But the teeth were
asked
a bitch.
Him to get his key back. He did it on his own.
Disgusting.
313-298-WRF.
You want to see my little thing?
Wants to tell us what they've
about whatever?
Retrieved. Yeah, okay. What'd you bring?
I have to give credit to our intern, Chris, actually brought this for
me. I'll go ahead and tell what my show and tell was this morning. I brought in a movie called A Girl Thing, which has the sexiest, hottest lesbian love scene in the history of movie making.
That's true. That is true.
Kate Capshaw and Elle McPherson.
Yep. That's true. I will say, that is a fact. I've never seen anything like it. Two hot lesbians, and oh my God, do they kiss.
Listen to this note I got from Mark. The Roseville Police Department's hold music is Harper. I'm shocked. Roseville Police.
Oh.
I'm sure that's a tough, gruff bunch of hardworking guys.
Of course they are.
Harp around
and they're all listeners. And they all listen to us. Every one of them. You Roseville cops. We know this. We know you don't have any say over it. All right, you ready, Drew?
Yeah.
Look what Chris got me. You don't believe it.
Oh, you have a Billy doll.
The Billy doll.
The Billy doll. The makers of which flirted with you on the telephone.
That's right.
Where did
that
he get
guy
that?
Loved me. He found it in Royal Oak, some gay place.
Chosen
book. Some chosen
book. Well, I guess that there's a lot of gay.
Oh, Walter's all up on the gay card shops around town.
How do you open this, Chris?
I asked him where he got it. He said chosen books.
Yes,
I've
chosen
seen
books.
That rainbow laden store all over.
There's nothing wrong with being a gay oriented store having gay.
I'm going to go there.
Is that the place with the gay cards?
Yeah.
Because I was looking at cards in that store, and every one of them you open up, and there's
playing
a big
cards?
Dick. No, it's like a...
Oh, like greeting cards.
Yeah, like, you know, sorry, not feeling well. And then you open up, there's a giant, giant dick.
And it folds out. It folds out at you.
Hope this makes you feel better.
Right?
It's like, yeah, of course.
See, you, at the Billy doll, you need to go here at the bottom.
Oh, yeah, you got to
really
do it. You got to enter...
Got snaps.
Yeah, you got to enter the doll case from the rear.
Yeah.
You haven't opened the case yet?
No, it's now you're fisting it. Get your fist out of that.
Chris,
get your fist out of that.
There you go.
And Billy, of course, is dressed in
leather. He's tied up.
He's wearing studs wrapped around his arm.
I can already.
He's buff.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can buy him uniforms, too. Like, he comes Wall Street Billy.
Oh, really?
San Francisco Billy.
Billy wouldn't be a Wall Street guy, would he?
No, I don't think so. Would he?
I don't think so.
What's in this optional carry? Oh, that's his hat.
See, that's Rob Halford's look.
Oh, man, Drew, this is something. I don't know what anybody else got for Christmas, but this is really...
Yeah,
the
Cowboy
guy,
Billy,
when we called...
Sailor
this,
Billy?
This is over in France, and that guy was in love. Let me put his hat on. Oh, it's an airline pilot hat.
What?
Just like
Billy.
Just look like at the yours. Noticeable. Look at the noticeable bulge. Look at the bulge.
Billy's got a bulge through leather pants, and you can see the complete outline of his helmet and shaft.
And the belt. Actually, you have to take the belt off.
Oh, there's a real belt on that belt.
Who's going to de-pants the doll now? It's got to happen.
Not me.
You know, Chris, would you do it? I don't want to take the email.
I don't depend adult gay men in leather pants.
I don't want to take the hit.
Only teenage alleged heterosexuals like Gilman.
Chris just de-pants the doll.
Look at
the size of the dick on his face.
By scale, this doll's got like a 14-incher. And he's also got shaved pubes.
So he sizes up to me.
Look at the detail. I'll bet there's...
It's like about 10 inches.
Oh, my God, there is a...
There's a vein. There are veins in the Billy Bell's penis.
And there's a dick hole.
Yes, there is.
There's a dick hole. Balls. And Walter's running over for a close look. Look at this.
The doctor did a nice job of the circumcision. Can't you see from where the circumcision is? The doctor did a good job on
it. Gee, look at the size of that.
Get on your knees and get on it.
Stop. It's as big as his arm.
Hang from behind.
When you look from behind, you see these big balls hanging.
It's missing a hole, though. He's an a-hole.
He's not got an a-hole.
This is another great Sex in the City subject.
No a-hole.
When this guy lost his testicle.
Yeah.
To a testicular cancer.
Oh, God, yeah.
Which is really no laughing matter, although
no,
they turned it into one.
Oh, geez.
He wanted to get this implant, and so all the girls are having this discussion about how they really didn't care about bag size or ball size.
Mm-hmm.
And I was inclined to believe that they really thought that, just because this is kind of a chick-oriented show. Probably a lot of chicks involved in writing it. But it seems like chicks would, you know, just like anything else. Just like any other genital, the bigger the better.
Oh, yeah. God, yeah. It's always bigger the better. Bigger the better.
Hey, Mark. Mark, are you there?
God, the veins. Veins on the doll.
Jim still there?
No.
We should take a photograph of this doll and put it on the internet. You know that?
Hey, Ray. Yeah.
Hey, what's happening?
How you doing? Hey, man. What'd you swallow?
I didn't swallow nothing, dude. My cat swallowed... Pot.
Swallowed what?
Swallowed my pot, my herb.
Oh, you're kidding.
No.
That's not good.
Don't tell me you smoked it after you got it out of the kitty litter.
No, I thought about it, man, but... and I didn't even think about the story until I heard you guys talk.
Okay. Heads up on the language there, pal.
Turd smokers.
Turd smoker. All right, 313-298-WRIF. We got to take a break.
Yeah,
it's 7...
We sure do.
8:44. It's 22 degrees out, mostly sunny, they say, this afternoon, and a high just above freezing where it'll be tomorrow, too, partly sunny with a high of 35. Saturday, 32 for the high, and then Sunday, just the upper 20s with a chance of snow. There's a chance of snow on Saturday, too, but make it 23 degrees right now at the Riff.
Drew and Mike.
Oh, those guys are back!
101 WRIF. Riff. 101 WRIF Detroit.
Great. The Billy Doll staring me in the face. Boy, he is hung.
Oh, my. The size of the dick on that thing.
And the doctor did do a great job of the circumcision.
Oh, yeah.
On the Billy Doll.
And there's a dick hole.
And I would
and
know.
And there's veins.
I would know.
Right, look at the vein
job
detail.
On you.
They force you to unbuckle the belt, for God's sake.
Be proud of that sort of thing.
Mr. Walsh.
I had a plastic surgeon do my circumcision.
I've just never heard anyone brag about it.
I'm trying to start a new trend for no apparent reason. Hey, here's some email we got while we were gone, and since we've been here, we were already inspiring some email.
Wonderful.
Monster's Ball with Billy Bob Thornton and Halle Berry. Those of you who are on Mr. Skin... can go to the Mr. Skin site and see new nude clips of Halle Berry.
Ah.
And she's really nude in this one. It appears she's taking something from behind, too. Look at these.
Really? Well, we know she's... Oh, boy, she is being taken a pounding from behind. A pounding.
You got to admit, she is one fine, fine lady.
She is. I have an idea she's a bitch, though.
Yeah, that bandage on the forehead after the car accident was the dumbest thing I've ever seen.
Oh, that was just idiotic. And of course, we know she's a terror behind the wheel.
I'm enjoying it.
She is just taking it. Oh, my God. Look at that series of photographs.
MrSkin.com and Monsters Ball is the movie with Billy Bob Thornton. She's quite nude.
Ooh, she is bent over and getting it good and hard.
Wow. Let's see. Here is Susie who says, Drew and Mike, tell your listeners, they don't need to buy Semenex. This is the product that improves the taste of certain...
God, here I'd forgotten about that.
My boyfriend and I have a home remedy. It's coffee with two sugars. I'm serious about this. Boy, they went and really worked out a home remedy.
Sounds like it.
Well, that must have been fun for him.
unless it just turned out...
Oh, God, no.
Unless that day it just turned out to be something wonderful and it's just like, wow. And it was just like, I just had coffee.
Yeah, big placebo effect. She just thinks it...
I have it every day.
I know. Think about it. Yeah.
You must taste great.
Let's be good.
Get out of here. Oh, God. I feel like I should have clipped that.
The Billy doll's getting a boner. Pass me that other Billy stuff, Drew. The rest of the outfits.
The rest of the outfits?
Of
yeah, sure.
Yeah, can I have that?
You want to accessorize?
No. I don't know. Maybe. Okay. Go ahead. So coffee and two sugars in lieu of Semenex, a product we talked with the inventor prior to vacation.
In a cup, fool.
By the way, I love the show. Thank you.
Thank you.
Here's Patrick who says, for some odd reason, I was watching the Tournament of Roses Parade. At one point, the Columbine High School marching band was on. I figured since they've been out of the spotlight for a while, this is their monthly butting into our lives.
I know it. And of course, the announcers just went on and on, as you knew they would. And of course, Columbine was a school, of course, where there was the shooting. And they had to review the whole thing like no one knew what the Columbine school, you know. Nobody had a clue what that meant.
They said they were expecting them to play the Columbine Friend of Mine song. More email to come. I got some people on hold, though, from the break. Is this Jackie?
Yeah, hi.
How you doing? We're talking about the guy that had to crap out the diamond. And you had a story?
Yeah, actually, my husband was changing the fishing line on his fishing rod.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow my cat got a hold of some of the fishing line. Well, it was probably about 2 feet, 3 feet of it.
Ooh.
So a couple days later, I see my cat chasing his tail. Well, he had swallowed all the fishing line. So needless to say, someone was pulling it out.
Oh, that's
man.
Nice. That's nice.
Oh, geez.
And did it proceed to catch any fish?
No, I don't think so.
Yeah, what bait that would have been.
Thanks, Jackie. Hey, Rick.
Yeah.
How you doing?
Good.
Your wife had to, ooh.
She had to go through to find a diamond earring. That had Dalmatian. It took an earring right off her ear.
Oh, Dalmatian took an earring off her ear?
She took a diamond earring. She was wearing diamond earrings, and it ate one of them.
Oh, jeez.
So, now what do you do with the dog? Because dogs, of course, you know, don't go in a litter box or anything. Just had to follow the dog around outside.
Outside, and we had a big backyard. Every day she went out, looked all over. And I made her do it outside. She took a plastic bag out, put it in there, went through it. And after a couple of days, she found it.
Ooh. And she wears it now?
Yeah, I wasn't going to buy her a new one.
Did you take it to the jeweler and ask for a polishing?
Well, see, I am a jeweler, so I put it in a plastic bag, took it to work, gave it to one of the kids there, said, here, clean this.
Mm-hmm.
How much was the earring worth?
Maybe about $200. So.
Substantial. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
I think she was worried more about it doing damage to the dogs. It was just the earring in the post, you know?
Yeah.
So I could have, like, post.
Well, then why does she need to find it?
Well, she wanted to make sure she found it so it wasn't, the dog wasn't bleeding inside her.
Oh, I see.
Does she wear it now?
That was her main concern.
But does she wear it now?
I don't know. We're divorced. I don't know. She probably pawned it.
You're divorced after all of that.
Hey, John.
Hello.
What's up? What'd you swallow?
Swallowed a crown from one of my molars.
Boy, crowns are expensive, too. That's not something that you want to pay for twice.
Yeah, no kidding. I was having some work done, and they had put it in temporarily.
Oh,
and,
those temporary crowns.
One night at dinner, it was a...
No, you wouldn't fish out a temporary crown.
In my mouth, and chewed real fast and swallowed, and it was gone.
Mm. Ooh, and
dumps later?
Yeah, how many dumps later?
About 3 days of crapping in a Ziploc bag, and doing the pinch test. I walked back into the dental office, agreed with two laughing hygienists. They cleaned it up and put it back in.
No, they didn't. They put it back in.
Sure they did.
They promised me they cleaned it.
Well,
what was that? The crown was probably worth $500-$600, right?
Oh, yeah.
Man.
Oh, boy.
No, jeez.
Hey, Kurt.
Hey, how's it going?
How you doing?
Good. Yeah, my dog ate a sock.
Oh, and did you notice it when it came out or when it went in?
When it came out.
Oh,
yeah,
man.
My wife was cleaning it up in the backyard, and there's the sock.
Oh, that must have been horrifying for the dog.
Oh, yeah, I tried passing it. She started throwing up in the middle of the night. We thought she just got some bad grub, you know. Mm. So my wife's out in the backyard the next day, and she says, hey, I found my sock.
Oh, my God.
The dog also makes habit of eating all the toilet paper, so you walk out in the backyard, and there's all these little white piles.
I don't want to eat this while I'm eating.
Boy, dogs will eat anything.
You know, I can't believe it. Dog fiber like the supermodel.
Yeah. Mm. I can't believe it. In a sock.
Wow.
I think that would be hard to swallow, doesn't
just
it?
To pass
it. Stick in the throat?
Mm.
So they would choke on it.
Hey, hey, Greg, what's up?
Hey, I was just calling about the guy with the diamonds.
Yeah.
We had a buddy who were playing quarter bounce, and he swallowed the quarter. And he ended up getting it back, and that became like the official quarter for quarter bounce.
How cheap is this guy? He goes through it for a quarter?
Oh, yeah.
I hope it was right on top or somewhere. Jeez. I hope he didn't go through.
I don't know the details. I just sort of pulled it out. And
well, you guys.
That became the official quarter.
I guess you guys are in love with feces.
Tight. Yeah. Very tight. Yeah.
Thanks for the call. 313-298-WRIF. I'll do a couple more emails here.
That just came up tails.
Let's see. You guys need to play Chris Farley from the grave. Okay. Drew and Mike, this is from, listen to this email from Ron.
Mm-hmm.
Drew and Mike, so I'm banging this heifer, right? Lights out. Yes.
Jeez.
And it sounded to me like I was plunging a toilet.
Duh.
She called after about 2 weeks. I avoid her. Watch out for hogs driving Pontiacs. They call back and care and all that.
An email this is.
Also, my aunt's husband's niece is smoking hot, almost 22, 23. Nice rack and turd cutter. Would it be rude to put it in?
Turd cutter? How horrifying.
Here's what his sex sounded like with the girl with the Pontiac. Here's what his sex sounded like.
Oh, God. What a mess. What a mess. Oh, God.
Gross.
Oh, that's horrible. God. Oh, Jesus. Oh, that's
what kind
disgusting.
What kind of a weird dick do you have?
Jeez, it's probably in her armpit. God.
Sounds redneckish. Yeah, your aunt's husband's niece. Well, that's pretty distant. That's not even an in-law, really. Your aunt's husband is not a blood relative, so I'd say the niece is okay.
Nice turn cover.
Here's a January web girl for
Jeez.
You.
Hey, okay. And of course, you can see all the web girls, WRIF.com, and go right there and go to web girls, and there they are. And in the January theme is I love my body, and it shows. And so that means that whatever area of your body that you happen to really love, you can highlight it. In this case, it's the breasts.
How about them
And look
pictures.
At these close-ups are great. And
that is one piece of ace.
I tell you what, she is following the theme beautifully because this picture says, I love my body, boobs, and it shows. And it does show. And she's showing, and that's fantastic. And scan those things to DrewMike@WRIF.com. So keep on schedule for January here. Get that next web girl going.
Hey, guys, did you check out the Lord & Taylor After Christmas Sale and Clearance Catalog mailed out 12/20 and 12/24, green cover? If you did, look at pages 12, 13, 14, and 15. Patch your shadow. That's my question. Happy New Year.
One of those.
I don't know.
Okay. One of those tricky ones.
Yeah.
Well, there's always one that gets by here and there. It happened once. It was a Montgomery Ward ad once where the thing was hanging out. Half of a crotch, and it was corrected like 2 days later for the same ad.
Let's see, a couple others here. Well, you got a few submissions for web.
Oh, that's great. Yeah. Fantastic. What a great showing for December.
My name is Anthony. I've been listening to the show for about 2 years. I'd like to thank you for helping me in all Detroit every morning with a good laugh for some cool info. The reason I'm emailing is I'm leaving January 3, that's today, for the United States Army. We'll not be back until springtime.
Ooh.
Well, I don't know how much I appreciate what all you do for all us hardworking Michiganders. Hey, thank you. Private Anthony J. Bush from Canton.
Hey, man.
Mike, can I get a bitch for all the armed forces?
Hey, armed forces. Hey, guys. Hey.
Guys, love the show. I was made to take my shoes off at the airport and inspected the gate by a security guard named Mohammed on my way to Vegas last week.
Are you serious? Yes. Oh, come on. Shoes on the other foot, so to speak.
He thanks Northwest for hiring.
Oh man. See, this
can
shoe
you believe it? I can't believe this
I can't
clown.
Believe this shoe guy. Yeah,
yes.
I know.
Now we all have to take our shoes off.
Now everybody has to take their damn shoes off. Plus the fact that, wouldn't they, somebody noted? I can't believe this guy got on the plane. First of all, to be walking around with all those plastic explosives in his shoes, so he'd have been walking a little funny. Well, thank God he was a moron.
Let's see. Let Drew know the reason the Lions game is sold out is because it was supposed to be the home opener. Duh, I knew that.
Yeah, but you know what? I think regardless it would have sold out. I really do.
Because
it's the last game. It's the last game in the stadium.
They've got to win, though.
I think it's just because it's the last game. It's the goodbye Silver Dome for the Lions.
It's the Tigers opening day.
The Bears significant.
The Bear game wouldn't have sold out if the Chicago people hadn't come through.
I think the very last game would have sold out just Keith, on that merit.
Keith says, I can't believe you're criticizing Boston for the national anthem at the Fiesta Bowl. 99% of sporting events have either pop band of the day or some loser lip-syncing, or some fat dude. Fiesta Bowl has a band up in the stands jamming an instrumental version of the anthem. All right. Oh, he likes Boston. He thought it sounded good. Hey, Mike, don't start the new year touting the Spartans. They played in the Toilet Bowl against the California high school team. Nice big win.
It was a huge win, and sorry about your Wolverines, who got their ass handed to them. God, what a debacle. What shameful performance.
Alan, subject, lesbo scene. Drew, Kate Capshaw, isn't she old? Kate Capshaw, I don't care how old she is. She looks great in this lesbian scene with
Elle
McPherson.
Elle McPherson, yeah.
A Girl Thing. It's called A Girl Thing is the movie. If you want to see an incredible lesbo scene.
Oh, God.
Ooh.
Really is. I mean, they kiss and they mean it.
Well, according to our audience Insta poll, 46% say you're too old.
Boy, the tongues are going and they both look hot. And the kissing just goes and goes and goes. That was phenomenal, really.
Let's see. Subject, help, can't hear you. Why can't I listen live through your home website anymore? I miss you at work. They have me in a dungeon. Radios don't work. I don't know. Well, there shouldn't be any reason why we're not online, is there?
Real audio should be going.
I don't know what that's all about. Could be temporarily out, maybe.
Unless the server's full.
Andy says the DVD for Blow is great. They had the interview with the Depp character.
Oh, I got to see that. George Jung. And of course, I finally saw the movie over our vacation. I thought it was a great movie.
His daughter's in the movie. She plays someone in the bank where he launders his money. Mm. Also want to let you know, I had a little outburst at the movie theater because of your show. I went and saw Vanilla Sky with my girlfriend. I was noticing how Penelope Cruz is pretty, a.k.a. I would sleep with her, but she wasn't hot. Her rack leaves a lot to be desired. However, my outburst can... How can you be criticizing that. Penelope Cruz? She's got a decent
rack. Well, I tell you, in Blow, she was hot.
Yeah. I think she's hotter. Hot. I think she's hotter in Vanilla Sky.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I don't see Vanilla Sky. That's going to be another year before I see that one.
Cruz is sleeping in bed. What you think? Well, I can't reveal all that. Oh, Cameron Diaz reaches over from behind him and starts rubbing his stomach. Well, Cameron Diaz has man hands, and I really thought Cruz was getting rubbed by a man. So in the theater, I shouted, "That's a dude's hand!"
He shouts that out in a movie theater. I can't believe it. Imagine breaking the silence in a theater to shout that. Everybody cracked up and agreed.
Oh boy. Let's see. Hey, is this Michelle? How you doing? Michelle?
Oh.
Is this Mike?
Yep.
Hey, Mike, what's up?
Hey, how's it going, guys?
What are you calling about?
Well, we were up at the topless place in Lansing one time, and I was there with a couple guys who apparently were regulars there because they knew everybody. And this girl came over, and she got real close to the guy and was rubbing the inside of his ear with, you know, the end of her chest, and all of a sudden, she grabbed it and squeezed it and just filled his ear up with breast milk.
Oh!
So then then she backed up, and he's, like, rubbing his ear, going, what the hell is that? And she, like, grabbed it again and squirted all of it. She just
Oh, my God. I think I'd have a heart attack.
Oh, my God.
Is that bizarre? Oh. How freaky was that?
Yeah, it was a little weird at the time.
Yeah.
It wasn't exactly what you'd expect to get out of a place like that.
A little unexpected. That would completely flip me out.
Oh, jeez.
Thanks for the call, though.
God.
Hey, Greg.
Hey, how you going?
Hey, man.
Your dog ate something?
My dog ate my old lady's underwear.
Oh, for God's sake.
3 weeks before our wedding. It cost us $1,843 to have the little bastard fixed.
Wait.
Yes.
What do you mean?
Because it was lodged?
The medical bill, you mean?
Yes.
Surgically extract the thing, or what?
They took 22 inches of his intestines out.
No!
Oh, yeah.
Whoa.
Oh, yeah. We had to take him to a 24-hour emergency vet overnight. We had to take him on a stretcher. Oh, it's terrible. Worse than I do for myself or my wife.
Stretcher.
Oh, my God. And in the end, it was a pair of panties.
Was it a nice pair of panties?
They wouldn't bring them out. Let me see.
You didn't get the panties back?
That's outrageous.
Oh, my God. That's horrible. Is this Kathy?
Yeah.
Hey, Kathy, what's up?
I was calling about my dog ate some tinsel.
Tinsel?
Yeah, from a tree.
I wouldn't think that would be good.
No. So I didn't know he ate it. I was taking him out for a walk, and he was doing his little number on someone's lawn. I took my bag over, and I was watching. There was shiny hanging out, so it never came out. I had to take the bag and pull it out, and he went, yup.
Oh, God. Well, have you ever been more horrified in your entire life?
No.
Thanks for calling, I guess. We're talking about this because this guy in Roseville ate a diamond to avoid being busted, I guess. Or just steal it. I don't know. I don't know what he was trying to do. Anyway, they're waiting for him to pass the diamond at the Roseville Police Station. Is this Dwayne?
Yeah.
Hey, Dwayne, what's up?
How you doing, man? I got a golden retriever.
Yeah.
And a couple years ago, he ate a tube sock.
Oh.
And, you know, we didn't even know. So I'm looking outside, and he's squatted down for like 20 minutes. So I go out there, and he's got like a piece of it hanging out. And I had to help him.
Oh, yeah. Well, similar to our last story. Okay, I think we've heard enough of these stories, but thanks anyway, Dwayne.
All right.
See ya.
Bye.
Oh, God. Okay. Traffic at 12 after 9 o'clock, Mr. Stress, and it's brought to you by, let's see, how about, I'm going to just take a crazy guess and say it's brought to you by Body Solutions. Doug Podell lost 34 pounds. It's the evening weight loss formula. Call and order today at 1-800-416-3995. Mention WRIF and get a 20% discount. 1-800-416-3995. Hey, Stress.
Hey, earlier there was a big old car fire, I-94 westbound before 96. That resulted in just the left lane being open, but now the problem is resolved. All the lanes are open, just so you know. However, it is still bumper-to-bumper and miserable through the Chalmers-Connor area, but that's all residual backup, so don't worry. It'll get better. That's it. That's a hell of traffic.
All right. Trudi News, what's happening?
Well, now that it's 2K2, who's going to be the first with wheel deals to keep the car biz buzzing?
Well, it's GM, right?
It's General Motors who are leading with these $2,002 rebates, and they expect that Ford and Daimler Chrysler are going to be pressured into following them after the 0% financing deals expired, a lot of them, except...
Do you want to hear about my slowest moment in the history of my brain?
Yeah.
I was reading this story this morning.
I'd love to hear you being...
This is the slowest moment in the history of my brain. When I saw $2,002, it's like, why $2,002? Why not just $2,000? And then I got mad at myself.
101. Sometimes we give away 101. 1,001.
I was shocked at my own stupidity.
Oh, my God. Well, I guess it takes
a
while.
I'm only admitting it because it was therapeutic.
Well, I've got a lot of therapy this morning, haven't you?
Yeah.
They're saying about the Daimler-Chrysler deal, too, that they're extending their 7-year, 1,000-mile powertrain protection plan until the end of March. And that kind of, like, adds up. I know you're slow, but if you put those two together, I don't know, Durango time, maybe.
Could
be time to shop Durango. Ooh, Durango. Silver, by the way, is the number one color, according to the paint people. They do a survey every couple years or so, and they check what everybody's favorite car color is. Silver's number one. It beats white out, which was the last most popular car color, strangely enough. So
I
now
have to get
it's
a new car if they're going to give them away.
Yeah.
If you're going to make it that easy, I might just have to get one.
Oh, no. I mean, I think the effort to just get up and go do it is harder than actually, you know, getting in. I think how much fun that'd be, too. New car smell.
I know. I'll sell my
clean.
I'll sell my worthless Kmart stock. Buy a car.
They actually are saying Kmart. They're trying to hang in there. That they are doing.
Well, Kmart says this isn't true.
They're.
You know, somebody just came out and said, "Oh, they're going bankrupt. Sell the stock now."
Now, who is that?
Who would say something like that?
Do you have for making a statement like that? Does it help you in the market in some way if you make an announcement like
if
that?
If you're
that,
right, yeah.
That harms the...
Say, see, I knew when Kmart sucked. I knew exactly the moment.
Yeah, but do you profit off of that in any way if it impacts the actual stock market? People hear it and they, you know, start dumping or...
I suppose if you've already sold it at a much higher price and then you buy it back at a real low price after it's been shot down.
Well, they've taken great pains to say, hey, you know, we're handling things, okay? They got some bad news from Wall Street. The Prudential Securities yesterday downgraded their stock from hold to sell. The financial services organization citing Kmart's lower than expected fourth quarter sales and earnings and some cash flow problems. However, you know, Kmart is saying, hey, we're going to hold the fort and we're doing what we can. And we've got strategy there.
What are they going to say? Yeah, they're right. We're panicking too. We're selling ours. All our executives are dumping it.
It's never cool to say that, I guess, is it?
No, not when it's yours.
In Detroit, we are keeping that Muslim leader under our thumb now, Rabib Haddad from Ann Arbor. He's still being held. Over the past week, Elizabeth Nubani, the judge on this case, decided that on the grounds that he had a shotgun and the fact that his visa is expired, she thinks that it's good enough cause to deny bond for Haddad, although there are those who believe that he's being treated unfairly and profiled because of his situation, because he's a Muslim leader, too, in the community, and they also deny that he had anything to do with fundraising for the Al-Qaeda guys. Then there's wacky Zaki Massawi. He is the first indicted as a so-called 20th kamikaze hijacker arraigned yesterday in Virginia. Of course, his big first chance to speak up. And what he says is, in the name of Allah, I do not have anything to plea and enter no plea. Thank you very much. And then he would not stand in deference to the judge when the judge asked him to please rise and entered a plea of innocence on his behalf because he couldn't make his own plea. He, of course, is this guy who flunked out of flight school. Actually, he didn't flunk, but he was so bad at it that it brought the flight school guys' attention to him. They wondered why he would spend thousands of dollars on flight school when he was such an ass. And then they called the feds, and so he never made it.
Well, by what he said yesterday, I just assume he's guilty. He should be screaming that he didn't do it.
I'm tired of his picture. Are you tired of his face?
I am too, yeah. Do something.
I'm really tired
of his picture. Put a toupee on him or something. I don't know. Do something with him.
I'm sick of seeing that face of his.
Yeah.
Snow for the south, deep freeze below the Mason-Dixon. It's thrown the entire southern United States into a panic. Like Atlanta, where at Hartsfield Airport, they had to haul out airline de-icers. Unheard of. And there weren't enough to handle the tasks, so the city had to cancel a lot of Delta flights. And South Carolina has called out the National Guard. North Carolina, they're going on maybe 7-8 inches of snow in this place where they're totally unused to having snow. And a lot of people driving like crazy people. You know, they can't handle it, of course. Here in Michigan, we've got it all under control, but...
Yeah, we like to think we do. we do pretty badly sometimes.
Well, that's at the beginning of the year, but, you know, that's like a mulligan.
Yeah.
And it's the first snow of the year, which we really haven't had any to speak of. Kwame Kilpatrick is making the rounds. It's his big inauguration week. He's having all kinds of celebrations.
Did he get four ribs removed? I thought he had two removed.
He's taking the oath of office in a public ceremony at the Fox Theater. I don't even with ribs removed, I think it'd be a little difficult for him.
Oh,
logistically.
Well, yeah, he's a big guy.
Marilyn Manson.
They retired his number from his high school. Did he go to Cass Tech?
Did they?
Yeah, they retired his number because he's...
Sweet.
Supposedly because he's so good at football, but it's because he's...
He looks like he'd be good at football.
Oh, he's
kind of a shouldery sort of a guy.
He didn't go pro is because he got injured, but his college coach didn't remember it that way.
Oh?
Yeah.
Another sort of murky Kilpatrick story? How did the college coach remember it, Drew?
He remembered it that he just didn't quite make it.
Oh.
I think that was
how
he remembered
it.
Yeah, he just wasn't maybe good enough.
Oh.
He was acknowledging he was a good player, but he didn't remember that as being the reason he didn't make it in the pros.
They need a... It's crazy. They need a slew of extra brawny guys to do security around the Taj Mahal in India because the Indian government got an email that somebody was going to try to bomb it. By the way, if you have instant messaging or somebody you know uses instant messaging a lot, like a lot of little kids will get together with their school buddies and instant message each other. Mm-hmm. AOL is supposedly warning people that there is some sort of a hacker hole that will allow hackers to come in through the back door in your computer via Windows instant messaging program. So look out. Heads up.
This is reminding me of something.
What's that?
There have been stories in the paper the last couple days. I think the entire state of Michigan, is it the entire state or is it just most schools ban cell phones on students?
Mm-hmm.
Because, of course, they ring in class. And they go out during recess, and they call their drug friends, and, you know, it's easier to get your drugs delivered and make your social plans, and it just isn't very productive.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of parents are teed off because they want to know if Ray didn't come through and he didn't have a cell phone to call me on. See, no, now we have cell phones, no one has to really plan anything. Have you noticed that?
Yeah, I know. You can be really spontaneous as you want to be.
You don't have to plan anything. You have to plan when you're going to meet at a certain place. Well, just call me on your cell when you get close. Or, you know, you don't have to plan directions. Well, just get to 75 and then call me on the cell.
I mean, that's great, though. I think that's
I love it.
Awesome
I
freedom.
It.
Mm-hmm.
But I noticed in this story about teenagers having cell phones, it was the same way. No one wanted to have to plan anything. So they did this big study on cell phones to find out, are they really helping teenagers? Are they really safer?
Dude, they're helping everyone.
Oh, I know they're helping me.
We know the correct time because of cell phones.
True.
Mm-hmm.
However, what they found out was that that kids were doing more and more things like further and further from home because they could just say, well, I've got my cell phone, so you can always call me to make sure that I'm not at the concert in East Lansing trashed out of my mind because I called you and we talked or, you know, you know that I have a ride home
right,
or whatever. But
everybody's
the amazing really sure. thing in the story was a quarter of the teenagers that they surveyed, I think there was like, you know, 14 to 17, you know, mostly high school, a quarter of them had cell phones. And their bills were, I think it was $120 to buy the cell phone and $56 a month. And I was like, wow, I'm amazed parents will pay $56 a month for their kid to have a cell phone.
That's not such a good deal, is it?
It's a lot of money. Well, yeah, they can have a better plan. They run up bigger phone bills than they're supposed to, of course, because it's supposed to be an emergency tool to call mom.
Oh, yeah, and it never is.
But they call their friends 90% of the time, and the kids in the story admitted it.
Oh, yeah, where's the party, you know? Next thing you know, they got to get the next plan, you know? They got to get 100 minutes.
But that seems so obvious to me. I could not believe there were actually parents who thought that their kids were only going to use cell phones to call them and hear
the
ride.
The parents should know, because in the beginning, I think they started out that way. Here you go, honey. You got a cell phone? And yeah, just in case, you know.
Yeah.
And now she's calling him to find out where the hell her husband is half the time.
Marilyn Manson got off in court over the holidays where they cut him sort of a break for smearing his groin up against that hapless security guard at the DTE Ozfest appearance. They've given Manson 30 days to make a plea on reduced charges of assault and battery and disorderly conduct. Drug dealers in Australia, enterprising folks that they are there, using Harry Potter's name on tabs of ecstasy. E-dealers have been dealing in Harry Potter ecstasy with a special little picture of a witch flying over the moon lately over the internet. Lord of the Rings, Lord of the Box Office, number one for the holiday weekend that ended on Tuesday. Second, Ocean's 11, and then Jimmy Neutron. Ali was fourth. Did you see that?
No, I didn't. Mike saw it. He didn't like it. Did you see it?
I did.
Ollie,
yeah,
did you like it?
Yeah, there was some slow parts, I thought. It kind of dragged
it. From Mike and also from someone else that it is too long.
Yeah. Yeah, because it goes at sort of a snail's pace.
I feel like
he spends this entire, 5 minutes in this film looking at a wall in Africa, just pondering,
How's Will Smith?
Actually good. I believed him as Ali.
I just know so much about Ali, and I know it so many times over.
You know what's weird, though, was John Voight as Cosell.
John Voight as Cosell?
Yeah.
Horrible.
Horrible?
Horrible.
He was
the worst Cosell I've ever seen.
He was like a Muppet, sort of. I mean, he was so transformed as it.
Hmm.
And
we're going from the darkness to the light.
You're lucky he held me back, man.
Everybody all across the world wants me to snatch that thing off the top of your head.
Ali,
We'll be right back.
You want some food for that
thing?
Sounded like him.
Now playing in theaters everywhere.
He sounds like him?
Yeah. I thought he sounded like him. I didn't realize that they were like spooning most of their careers either.
Definitely.
Yeah. Yep. Hand in hand, those two.
That's what kind of came as a shock to me.
It's hard for me to watch a lovers. Movie about someone that I know so well. It would be sort of like actors playing the Beatles or the Rolling Stones or something. I know over and over and over, and over and over and over and over.
It's like they're so-and-so pretending to be so-and-so.
Jim Carrey as Andy Kaufman, I enjoyed that because Andy Kaufman's story really, when the movie came out, was when I really learned a lot about Andy Kaufman.
Right.
I knew stuff about him, but I didn't know it that well. And I kind of enjoyed him.
That was sort of a revelation, by the way, his movie, The Majestic.
Oh, did it bomb?
Right about 10th on the list of movies people saw.
Wow.
Over the holidays. Not that great.
Well, that was a dramatic role, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Ouch.
Yeah. Kind of a snore.
Bye-bye.
A weird little shockumentary on plushies and furries that you might want to catch if you're interested in that sexual quirk. People who are sexually obsessed with wearing not lingerie teddies, but actual teddy bear costumes.
Oh, it's the stupidest thing.
Getting it on with each other in their little fuzzy outfits. On MTV tonight at 10, they've got a special documentary about why these folks are
We need to tape that.
It's already TiVo.
Oh, it's already TiVo. Excellent.
And Axl Rose was... Rose at the whole thing in Las Vegas when he performed at the casino. He was at the Hard Rock, and he told the security guys if he so much as saw any of the old Guns N' Roses bandmates, including Slash, he would leave the stage. And in fact, they turned Slash away at the door.
Actual audio of Slash trying to get in.
Yeah, frontsies, though. And then Axl, even though he didn't see any of his bandmates because security actually kept them out, had a couple of dozen hissy fits over the technical troubles that he claims he was having.
That guy is such a brat.
But he did do 2 hours. Trudy Daniels with Rock and Roll Radio.
Trudy brought to you by your Chrysler and Jeep superstores. Through January the 8th, get incredibly low lease payments on your favorite Chrysler and Jeep vehicles during 2 weeks to deal only at your Chrysler and Jeep superstores. We had a... not much of a match last night. Florida over Maryland, 56-23. They suspend the starting quarterback, and it didn't even phase Florida. Rex Grossman came in after a few series, threw 4 touchdown passes, 248 yards passing, and I guess he threw a bomb late in the game, which the crowd really reacted to. Like, why are you trying to rub it in? Come on, cut it out. It's crazy. Tonight, it's the national championship, the Rose Bowl.
Finally.
Miami and Nebraska. At 8 o'clock, Eric Crouch versus Ken Dorsey at quarterback. That could be very interesting. I'm excited about this game. I'm not really... I know there's some complaining because there's no Big Ten team in the Rose Bowl. Mike's upset because the Rose Bowl parade was on a different day than the Rose Bowl.
Well, I can't believe the game is like a year later after the fact.
Yeah, I know. I understand.
I don't like it that it's on a work night. You know, it's just...
The thing is, if they're all January 1st, they're all at the same time.
Well, that's why
all
they
these
need
games
to...
going at once. Of course, you can hunt and pick the good game.
I think like some of the other things, like, I don't know, Fiesta Bowl, Tostitos Bowl. By the way, I didn't see anybody go, hey, I have a little bag of Tostitos for you. never
that's all I can think of.
That. But if that stuff, if they could have had those maybe earlier. But I couldn't believe it. I was looking all over the TV guy. Oh, there's a Rose Bowl going here somewhere.
Lions game Sunday is a sellout. Of course, that was the first home game of the year. It's just being replayed. McMahon is doubtful. Porsche is in the Pro Bowl. He's the only Lion to make it. Desmond Howard is an alternate. Tom Brady, the former Wolverine, is a quarterback for the AFC. Red Wings 5-3 winners over Anaheim last night. Fedorov scoring from defense. His first goal since he started playing defense. What's up now? What's Scotty's really tinkering? He's really, I think, annoyed that this team is just not quite... not... where they were maybe 3 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
So he's tinkering. Scotty's the world all-star coach. Mike Badano gets his 400th goal. He becomes the fourth U.S. player to have 400 in his career. Pistons lose 97-85 to San Antonio last night, while Michigan basketball wins Bernard Robinson 16 in their win over Penn State. And then Brian Mueller signs with the Tigers for another year. Just 1 year for $2.4 million. And the winner in the most plugs in the shortest period of time, Bull, during the bowl games, goes to the Nokia Sugar Bowl.
Well, Greg and Pat, you know, not a bad way to start the Nokia New Year with $100,000. I know you've got to be pleased with the folks at Nokia. Just giving you a shot.
Hey, I appreciate Nokia for in my family and Joel Theismann.
Well, now let's bring in Pekka Vartanen from Nokia for the check presentation.
Greg, on behalf of Nokia, I'm very glad that you participated to Nokia $1 million challenge. And tonight, I'm also happy that Nokia paid off for you. And I'm glad to present this check of 100,000 US Nokia dollars for you tonight. Very happy Nokia New Year.
Happy Nokia New Year.
The Nokia cash.
The Nokia dollars.
Yeah. Go to the Exchange American cash for all Nokia.
I'll see a few more emails before we break. I was anxiously waiting for you to get back so I could find out about the Siemens product.
No!
It's, of course, from a guy. Of course, I wouldn't get caught in some useless conversation with my boss. I would get caught in some useless conversation with my boss as you guys were talking about it. I couldn't say, hey, wait a minute, I got to listen to this so my wife will want to...
I see.
Semenex.com. S-E-M-E-N-E-X.com. Mariah Carey subject from Al. Did you hear a record company canceled her $80 million recording contract? Is that true? I heard that was going to happen, and I...
How do you do that?
You can't do that, can you?
I wouldn't think so.
She came
sure
out.
Doesn't seem like it.
Was it just a greatest hits, or was it a regular album that came out? It was, I think, number 52 was where it landed.
Whew.
And they were in shock.
Yeah,
number 52, Mariah Carey.
That really is extremely surprising. Wow! Oh, she must be flipping her lid.
Oh yeah, and her boyfriend, her old, her just recent ex boyfriend, just went back to his ex girlfriend, who's younger and hotter. By the way, they have her picture in the tabloids.
Uh-oh.
Lesbo movie scene.
Well,
I don't know. 313-298-WRIF. Will someone tell me who is in that scene, or if you have an even better scene?
Yeah, because you want the two girls to be really hot, which is the case in this movie. Oh, my God, they're beautiful. Usually, every time it seems like in a non-X-rated flick where there's a couple of chicks, it seems to me one of them is always substandard in appearance every time. You never get the two... that are just gorgeous. And
well, that Bound scene is... That's a mighty fine scene.
What's the one with Nev Campbell?
Nev Campbell, Denise Richards, those are good, but they're not very... They don't go very far.
No, they don't go very far. And Nev Campbell, she's the one that's hot. Yeah.
Oh, I thought Denise Richards was even hotter than Nev Campbell.
I
don't like Denise Richards?
Nev Campbell.
You like her?
Well, in that moment.
And you don't like Denise Richards? Or not as much
as
Nev
Campbell?
Yeah,
I do, but not as much as Nev. I was on a Nev kick. But that's all right. I'll take them both.
313-298-WRIF.
Drew and Mike.
Why don't you get drunk and stumble around comically for my amusement?
101-WRIF. The Riff. 101-WRIF Detroit.
Well, it's pretty unanimous. The best lesbo scene is in the movie Bound. At least that's what the survey says. I think those people will be converted if they see a girl thing, which is in the new movie section. Someone wanted to know on emails that drama, comedy, whatever. I guess it's a drama. It's not really drama. I don't know what it is. But it's a new movie. And I think Mike's all over this with me. Elle McPherson and Kate Capshaw.
But Mike caught me in. Yeah, he's... Everybody likes it.
That's pretty
strong. It really is. I've never seen anything like it. I mean, the kissing is just... Wow.
Yeah, and she's kissing Elle's breasts, too.
Oh,
she'll
man.
Her breasts,
oh,
and Elle's nipples are hers.
The whole thing.
Tough scene, man.
The whole deal. Man.
Tomorrow, Gene Simmons. Gene's book is out, Kiss and Make Up. And, boy, I tell you, the ace stories were what were really tearing me up. Just tearing me up.
Of course. Ace is the place.
I read another good book over vacation called Easy Rider, Raging Bulls, How the Sex, Drugs, and Rock and Roll Generation Saved Hollywood. And it's sort of how Hollywood transitioned from, Rock Hudson, Doris Day, It's a Mad, 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 Mad World, to Easy Rider, Raging Bull. So, you know, some of the kind of hip happen movies, the more real movies that came along instead of, you know, the old geezer generation.
Right.
Our parents' generation. And it's a lot about the directors like Steven Spielberg and Martin Scorsese and Francis Ford Coppola or whatever the hell. And there's some great stories in this book. I highlighted a few. Every time I read about Warren Beatty, I always thought, what a pompous ass. I don't think I could ever like anything about him. But after hearing how he jerked Madonna around, that really amused me greatly. And then in this book, there's a lot about Warren Beatty that's very interesting, just how he gets his way and how he gets things done. But also, the way he chases women, his whole philosophy was with just being a complete, I take what I want, here's what I want, tell me if I can have it philosophy. His sort of foot in the door thing is, you get slapped a lot, but you get effed a lot, too.
Yeah. Well,
I can understand.
That's what we found out from people that, you know, that do approach women and just straight away
ask them. Yeah, how are you ever going to get
ask them
if you don't try, if you don't ask for it?
Right, right.
He asks for the order.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't ask for a date. He
right.
asks for the order.
And again, that's like this one guy I knew in high school. That's exactly what he did. He would go right up to the girl. We'd be at a bar and places rocking and everybody's dancing and everything. And he'd be just wasted. And he'd go up there and he'd right up to some chick and he'd right to her face. And there were times when all of a sudden everything would stop and you'd see him get slapped right across the face. We actually saw that a time or two. But this guy screwed more women. I mean, he probably of all the chicks at school, he had the most of them. And they were all hot. So, there you go.
One of Warren's many conquests was Michelle Phillips of the Mamas and the Papas, who...
Do you want to go on a field trip in my pants?
...was pretty damn hot.
Oh, she really was.
And she...
She was smoking hot.
...at Warren's request, took Warren to the gynecologist with her, and the gynecologist, because it was a Hollywood gynecologist, let Warren watch.
Oh, God. Oh, jeez.
So...
Hopefully it was just something routine rather than a problem.
Oh, I'm sure it was, but I decided there's a whole new industry there for gynecologists who allow you to bring a guest who can watch.
Well, they figure everybody's going to decline.
Yeah, I don't know why.
I think that's just
little,
something
little
private. That...
Well, but if it was Michelle Phillips at age 25, you might feel differently. He just met her.
Yeah. Oh, brother.
On to... Jeez. Billy Friedkin, who directed The Exorcist. Does that name sound familiar?
Not at all.
He directed a few big movies, Exorcist being the biggest. But anyway, he's interviewing Linda Blair, who's 12, for the role. Mm-hmm. And I always wondered this. How could you let your kid do that role?
Be that role. Yeah.
I mean, seriously, could you imagine
your
kid being
that's
in that
pretty
movie?
Weird, yeah.
Some of the stuff she had to say.
I know it. Yeah, the things she had to say. Well, yeah, sure. Yeah, you'd think that people would have been appalled. That she would say those things. And
Well, they print, because the book is about movies from Easy Rider to Raging Bull, they print the interview between Billy Friedkin and Linda Blair. He's interviewing her to make sure she can handle this role. He says, did you read the book, The Exorcist? Linda Blair, yes. She's 12, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
What's it about? It's about a little girl who gets possessed by the devil and does a lot of bad things. Now, what sort of bad things? She pushes a guy out a window, masturbates with a crucifix, and what does that mean?
Oh, man.
It's like jerking off, isn't it? This is a 12-year-old.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah. What do you know about jerking off? Do you jerk off? Oh, sure. You do that? Yeah, don't you? She got the role.
Oh, my God. And he got a boner, sounds to me.
I know. It did sound a little suspicious. But
oh, yeah. That just sounded like he had alternative motives.
When you hear about this guy, though, you realize that he was really not into anything 12 years old. He was into anything else, though. This guy was such a horn dog.
Jeez.
They said Billy Friedkin, generally after the success of The Exorcist, funny, as soon as these guys have a hot movie, they are just in piles of women.
Because
most of them are complete nerds, like George Lucas, Steven Spielberg.
Right.
They're total nerds, these directors. Mm-hmm. Once they get a little ounce of power, all of a sudden there's chicks just falling all over.
Oh,
and they're ready for it.
Remember Lucas, that interview? Who was interviewing him, that chick that was falling all over him? She wanted to see
Leslie Stahl.
Yes. Oh, God. Remember that? And, did she want him, and he wanted nothing to do with her.
Oh, Pulp Fiction guy?
Yeah.
Boy, I'm having trouble with names today.
Quentin Tarantino.
I'm going to have to shorten my vacation.
Oh, nonsense.
I know. He had a series of one-nighters, one-week stands. A lot of girls with big breasts who gave great head.
Duh.
That was all Billy cared about. Bill Friedkin then says, the first sex I had was with a black hooker, $5 a pop. And for years, I would just see hookers. I don't know that I had the most healthy sexual upbringing. I was really a scoundrel. All I was interested in doing was getting laid. We were shooting The French Connection. Oh, he did The French Connection, too. On Madison Avenue and 69th Street in front of the Westbury Hotel, Gene Hackman was running down the street after some French guy, and a girl with blonde hair walked right through the shot. This is a pedestrian.
Yeah.
So, of course, caught, you know, because she's ruined the shot.
Yeah.
So he then sends an assistant, hey, run over, bring her back, because he's looking at the shot, and he's, boy, that girl's hot, the one in front of the shot. So he runs and has his assistant go and fetch this girl who's like a block away by now, brings her back, tells her who he is, and the next thing you know, he's doing her.
Oh, man. It was her lucky day. And I'm sure she considered that her lucky day.
Probably.
And she probably thought she was going to get some starring role in something.
69.
Yeah, that's where she got her starring role.
When Martin Scorsese moved to L.A., Brian De Palma introduced him to actress Jennifer Salt, who was making the rounds looking for work and a place to live. One day she tested for John Huston. He was directing Fat City. All the actresses wore the same dress. And when Salt pulled it over her head, the armpits were still wet from the woman who read before her.
No.
The woman who read before her was Margot Kidder.
Oh, man.
It was so tacky. Anyway, they end up talking. They become friends. Kidder was staying at the Sunset Marquee while she looked for work. She and Salt decided they'd find a place together. Kidder and Salt found a lopsided A-frame, unfashionably far from the action, up the Pacific Coast Highway, past Malibu, where the old Hollywood lived. Tom Pollock, an attorney who had a shack there, actress Blythe Danner, and producer Bruce Paltrow, lived nearby.
Bruce Paltrow.
Producers Michael and Julia Phillips, she produced The Sting and something else. She died yesterday, in fact. She's in the news today. She did a book called You'll Never Eat Lunch Again in This Town, which I've been desperately trying to get a hold of. They would soon move in next door, and a couple other writers lived up the hill. The Salt Kidder House, not to mention Salt and Kidder themselves, became a magnet for young Hollywood, a place where the wannabes could take a few tokes, drink red wine, trade stories, and stare at Salt, Margot Kidder, and Salt's old school chum, actress Janet Margolin, sunbathing topless. Salt and Kidder were the odd couple, the lady and the tramp. Salt was a princess from Sarah Lawrence. Kidder, from a blue-collar family, was raised in trailers and motel rooms. Kidder was sexually aggressive, not to say ravenous, and slept with nearly every man who crossed the threshold.
Yeah, boy.
She broke hearts and sued producers. She was heavily into the moment and struck her friends as not altogether stable, well, as we'd learned later.
Oh, yeah,
she was
very
half bald, asleep in someone's thorn bush.
Yeah, exactly. Wandering around, nobody could find her, wandering through yards.
Yeah, I thought someone was after her at the airport.
Beat up. Oh, yeah, just flipped her lid.
And, of course, she took drugs like they were going out of style. Always the first on her block to smoke, snort, or swallow the pill du jour. One day at the beach, Eve bit into the apple. It was unbelievable. Actor Peter Boyle brought over a vial of cocaine. Everybody was still on pot and psychedelics, so it was show-and-tell time. No problem for Margot Kidder. The only question is, well, how do you do it? Margot, of course, being Margot, said, oh, I'll try it. Margot says, because I didn't have the same amount of sensible paranoia that other people had, I stuck a straw in the coke and just went sucking in half the vial, which froze my lungs and made me unable to breathe. I was gasping, shaking my boots for 30 seconds. That was my introduction to cocaine.
Holy next question, smokes.
Next question was, where do I get more?
Oh, my God.
Out of the drug taking came a lot of swampy ideas, but also some creative thinking. Steven Spielberg didn't take drugs. Brian De Palma didn't. Martin Scorsese didn't until later when he got in trouble with coke. Margot started seeing De Palma. They were passionately in heat, making it everywhere and anywhere, once in a closet at another director's house during a party. She ends up with Spielberg, too, and she frequently is taking her clothes off to sunbathe, and Spielberg's freaking out.
And here everybody's pumping on her. Pumping on something.
Everybody. Everybody was, later on in the book. It seems everybody crosses Margot Kidder.
Everybody was pumping on her.
Robert De Niro turns up in the book, too, which is cool, because you don't read much about Bob De Niro's private life.
I guess he's pumping somebody.
Scorsese and De Niro took Mean Streets to the Cannes Film Festival in May. Marty, Bobby, and I were introduced to Fellini, recalls Taplin.
But Mike said, did you say Cannes Film Festival?
I guess he's pumping somebody.
You know, he's so easily amused.
That's
going to
stink.
Yeah, it's going to stink.
With the foreign sale of Mean Streets, the guys were in an expansive mood. Everyone went to lunch at Le Moulin des Mougins, I don't know, whatever, a four-star restaurant in the hills above Cannes. De Niro was there with his female companion of the moment. Bobby always had girlfriend trouble, said Taplin. He picked these incredibly strong chicks, top chicks, always black, and then he'd fight with them all the time. They would always...
Does it stink? Are you sure?
Yeah. I'm just being humorous.
Stenching. They would always be in tears the next morning. He would buy them some perfume. Marty, Sandy, De Niro, and the others were in the middle of an extraordinary meal when a bee the size of a small hummingbird buzzed the table. Sandy, this is the black chick, tried to ignore it, but it was making her nervous, and finally she called the waiter over. This bee is bothering me. Do something about it. The waiter took the towel off his arm and flicked it at the bee, which dropped stone dead into De Niro's girlfriend's water glass. She became hysterical, exclaiming loudly, "He killed the bee! I can't believe he killed the bee!"
Oh, my God, what a fruitcake.
De Niro says, "Will you can it?" This is him saying that.
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Fed up.
You're just going to let him kill the bee? It's just an effing bee! They were starting to attract the attention of the other guests. Tiro was getting angrier, said loudly, "Will you just shut the F up?" Why are you talking to me like that? They started screaming at each other. De Niro said, "Why don't you take an F and hike?" "I will," she said, and she stormed out of the restaurant.
I'm just being humorous.
Oh, man.
So they all then convene, and they're like, "Well, go get her, Robert.
What a scene.
Gotta go get her." He's like, "No, no, she'll be back, though. She'll be back. Just shut up. She'll be back."
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, she doesn't come back. And so after dessert, they're like, what do you want to do? He's like, "Let her effing walk, or she'll come back. Whatever. I don't even care." So they finished, they call a cab, and sure enough, about 5 miles down the road, there she was, walking the can.
What the f*** do you know?
De Niro said to her, "Get in!" She sulked all the way back the next morning, bought her a big bottle of perfume, and they were arm in arm.
Oh, jeez. Oh, man.
A lot of good stories like that.
If you have a problem with that, we can all go home right now.
Easy Riders, Raging Bulls, the sex, drugs, and rock and roll generation saves Hollywood. We'll take a break. We'll be back one more time with Trudi. Don't forget, tomorrow, Gene Simmons and the guy who farts to help people lose their phobias. Is that what he does? For therapy, he farts on them or farts at them? Or I don't know what he does. It's something like that.
Sounds wonderful.
Didn't sound like anything we'd turn down.
Sounds wonderful.
And we're not turning it down. He'll be with us tomorrow.
Drew and Mike. 101 WRIF.
How you doing?
Fine.
Pam told me she let you in on a little secret of mine last night.
Who am I talking to?
Jack Burns.
Jack Burns?
Yes.
This is a... Are you sure you got the right number?
Yes.
Okay. So what?
I'm just being humorous.
Okay.
All right, now look, Fokker. I'm a patient man. That's what 19 months in a Vietnamese prison camp will do to you. But I will be watching you, studying your every move. And if I find that you are trying to corrupt my firstborn child, I will bring you down, baby. I will bring you down to Chinatown. Hello?
Hello?
What's the matter with you?
What's the matter with you?
What are you, stupid?
Thank you for calling. It's Pam. May I help you?
Morning, Greg.
Okay, I'm sorry. You're calling for Greg or Greg. What is Greg's last name?
Yeah.
Greg, what's the last name, sir?
Jack Burns.
Sir, I don't have anyone listed by the name of Greg.
Pam told me she let you in on a little secret of mine last night.
What's that?
Well, as long as you can keep your mouth shut for the rest of your life, you're in no immediate danger.
Good morning. Thank you for calling. The North, this is Pam. May I help you?
Yeah, this Lester?
This is...
Okay. This is Sam Rothstein. I want to talk to Ginger. Put her on the phone.
Ginger doesn't work here.
I want to talk to Ginger. I want my kid back.
Oh, well, I don't know what you're talking about, sir.
Didn't we have a discussion yesterday in the car about this?
No, we did not.
Don't push it, Fokker. You're in a real mess.
Good morning.
Morning, Greg.
Can I help you?
Are you a pothead, Fokker?
Excuse me?
Don't push it, Fokker. You're in a real mess.
North?
How you doing?
Just fine.
Okay. Yeah, this Lester?
No, this is a North.
All right.
Pam told me she let you in on a little secret of mine last night. I'm just being humorous.
Can I
Jack
help you?
Jack Burns. Jack Burns.
Burns?
Huh?
You looking for a guest?
Yeah.
By the name of Burns?
Yeah.
There's no... Hang on just a minute. I might be in the wrong thing. Just one moment.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't see anybody here by the name of Burns.
This is Sam Rothstein.
What was the last name again?
This is Sam Rothstein.
Don't see that either.
All right. Yeah, is this Lester?
No, this is Leanne at the...
Yeah, I want to ask you something. How come Dorfler wound up on my ass? Did you put him on this, you son of a bitch?
Can I help you?
Greg, how come you don't like cats?
How come I don't like cats?
Yeah.
I like cats.
Don't push it, Fokker. You're in a real mess. All right, now look, Fokker. I'm a patient man. That's what 19 months in a Vietnamese prison camp will do to you. But I will be watching you, studying your every move.
He said, I'll be watching you. I'll be studying your every move.
Are you a pothead, Fokker?
Oh, have a nice day.
You stupid son of a bitch. You just blew it.
Thank you for calling. So I'll try to help you.
What are you doing?
What?
What are you doing?
What am I doing? Nothing.
Yes. Pam told me she let you in on a little secret of mine last night.
Who? Pam.
Yes.
Who is Pam?
Well, as long as you can keep your mouth shut for the rest of your life, you're in no immediate danger.
Okay.
I'm just being humorous. But the fact is, Greg, with the knowledge you've been given, you are now on the inside of what I like to call the Burns family circle of trust.
Okay.
Don't push it, Fokker. You're in a real mess.
All righty.
Take it easy. Yeah, is this Lester?
I guess. I don't know.
What, are you stupid?
I guess.
What's the matter with you?
Who is this?
This is Sam Rothstein. I want to talk to Ginger. Put her on the phone.
Who is Ginger?
I want to talk to Ginger. I want my kid back.
I don't know no Ginger.
My mother.
It's your mother?
Yeah.
There's nobody by the name of Ginger here.
All right, now look, Fokker. I'm a patient man. That's what 19 months in a Vietnamese prison camp will do to you. But I will be watching you, studying your every move. And if I find that you are trying to corrupt my firstborn child, I will bring you down, baby. I will bring you down to Chinatown.
All right.
I wouldn't even be in this situation if it wasn't for you. You brought down so much f***ing heat on me. I mean, every time I meet somebody here, the big question is, do I know you?
Are you crazy?
You had nothing to do with it?
No.
What the hell are we fighting for? We're friends.
Can I hang up now?
I know you all have 2 minutes and already I don't like you.
I'm hanging up now.
What's the matter with you?
I want to hang up.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
It's 10:04, 101 WRIF Detroit on day 3 of January.
I'm just being humorous.
2002. Trudy's brought to you, I know. How can it be 2002? It was just like 1993. Wasn't it? I just remember them signing up Boston for the Fiesta Bowl. They said Boston will perform at the next Fiesta Bowl. We can manage to get together for it.
Right.
It's about to be the 2001 December 3rd, or no, January 1st, 2002. It's crazy.
You can't adjust, can you?
No, I'm struggling.
You're working on it.
You're brought to us by, how about your Chrysler and Jeep dealers? Your Chrysler and Jeep superstores, December 24th through January 8th. Take advantage of low financing and factory-to-dealer incentives during 2 weeks to deal only at your Chrysler and Jeep superstores.
Detroit is fourth on the list of men's fitness magazine cities that need some Dr. Atkins. First on this list of the flabbies, Houston, Texas, which Fitness Magazine insists is the fattest of all U.S. cities. Second is Chicago. Third is Philly. And then Detroit. Fourth. We make the top five. Mm-hmm. Almost every year, right?
Fittest, yeah, we're always fat.
When they look at the state, though, the entire state, then I think Michigan ranks number one usually.
Yeah, the city, I think, is skinnier than the state.
Yeah, exactly. That's a fact. This is absolutely
true.
Well,
not who's leading it, but...
Yeah, that's true.
Fittest. San Francisco, Seattle, Colorado Springs, and Denver, Colorado are the fittest cities, according to Men's Fitness Magazine. Kmart, Stock Shock, some peckerhead leaked rumors of Chapter 11, and that sent Kmart's stock bumming out as a result, though the company in Troy says they have sufficient funds. Not only that, they've got strategies for a turnabout that involves massive operational and cultural changes. Nowhere in that statement did they say that they were filing anything. heat and lie sensing technology might come in handy someday.
This is kind of
And the kooky, that Mayo Clinic device that discovered they could actually use thermal imaging to detect lying among people, and the lies are in the eyes.
When somebody lies, what happens is there is instantaneous warming around the eyes. There's instantaneous changes in the heat patterns where the heat pattern around the eyes becomes white. And this occurs the instant people start lying.
And they may use this.
Get the Ramses
in the future
there.
To screen for terrorists at airports, among other things. Did that guy sound like Mr. Methane, by the way?
Yeah, he sounded very familiar to me. I like the idea of using it in an airport, but, you know, what if you walk in the door a little late and next thing you know, you're
somebody
getting questioned?
Somebody's thermally imaging your...
Yeah.
Incidentally, the shoe nut, the kook with the shoes at the air, Richard Reed tried to ignite his shoes mid-flight from Paris to Miami. The Justice Department says they will probably put Richard Reed on a plane again for Virginia from his cell in Boston if they discover that the sneaker bomber has links to Al-Qaeda. By the way, the other one, the ball guy, Zaki Moussaoui, they're also going to put him on trial in October. Court TV has a huge battle to decide whether or not the whole Moussaoui thing should be on court TV because the federal government doesn't allow cameras in a federal courtroom. So, Mariah Carey, she's probably going to have another meltdown. Her glitter movie and album bomb, paranoia setting in. She's hired those detectives to see who was leaking bad stories about her, and now basically, they have bought out her contract at Virgin.
They bought
like
it out.
Yeah.
God, I wonder what they paid.
Man.
Yeah.
Ooh, there's a,
get her out of there.
Somebody,
broom her out.
Two people have emailed this. I don't know if I believe it. They said that some of these Al-Qaeda people who are not giving up information as readily as most do when they're captured, they're forcing them to watch, you know, and listen to various things, sort of a torture treatment. And supposedly Mariah Carey's movie is one of the things they're making them watch.
Oh, come on.
I don't know if that's true or not. People just said it was in Time magazine.
That's hilarious.
No, that came from Tommy Mottola. Sony Records.
Maybe.
Wow.
By the way, Gene Simmons claiming that Eddie Van Halen actually asked him if he could join Kiss right before their breakthrough album. 1984 came out.
Was a funny, we'll ask Gene about that tomorrow. But Gene, in the book, the claim is that, amongst other things, they couldn't figure out, well, everybody knows Eddie. How would we put makeup on him? And what would his name be?
And he was just desperate enough because David Lee Roth was driving him absolutely crazy. And he didn't know what to do. This is before he had to make the decision about...
How could you not take Eddie
Van Hagar?
That's crazy.
I don't know.
Mira Sorvino says she hasn't done it, but some of her fellow actresses have told her that they did it. And sex scenes, they actually let it poke through.
Really?
Yeah.
Who's she talking about? Who are these sluts?
She won't say, but...
Oh, come on,
she says
Mira.
One of her actress friends said she actually did it in a very popular film we've probably all seen.
What could that be?
It was a $100 million five-album contract with Virgin Records.
Yeah, who's she friends with?
Oh, Mira? She worked with Mariah. In that last movie, remember, they actually fought each other, they wrestled with each other?
Well, you can bang Mariah between scenes. That's no big deal.
You can handle her big fat ass.
Cut! She just goes over and climbs on some extra.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that plane that...
Sweat hogs.
She doesn't even know the guy. She just climbs and just humps away until they say, all right, let's go.
Man, I just had a visual of it. That's how fresh I am.
She does. He's like sitting. She just sits in the
seat. I'm not immune to the...
She sits in the seat backwards right on and just goes...
Oh, God. Oh, gross. Gross.
And they say, let's go. And she's like...
Drew's pumping his pelvis at the invisible sweat hog's ass.
Running back to the set in near nothing.
The only difference would be there'd be a slap or two on her big heavy buttock.
I guess he's pumping somebody.
You'd slap that buttock and it would like quiver for a little bit. After you hit it, it would quiver. Like jello and then come to a stop. Rosy pink.
What it sounds like when she jumps on top of you when you're next to her.
Yeah.
No.
Or when you're just a grip or something.
Yeah. Well, this is what sounds like when she walks.
I'm ill. Totally sick.
I know. It's disgusting.
If you use instant messaging, do you use instant messaging for anything? If you do, you use the Windows version. AOL says there's a hole hackers discovered. Allows them to weasel in, possibly taking control of your computer or deleting your files. So don't talk to anybody except the people on your buddies list, supposedly. Mike Tyson, with his shirt off, went bonkers on some journalists. Got miffed when his New Year's trip to Havana attracted 5 reporters to his hotel. So he handled it just as you would expect. Iron Mike, too, throwing grapefruit-sized crystal balls at 3 of the reporters and clubbing a Reuters cameraman on the back of the head with his fist. Cameraman said, "He just went crazy on me," says Felipe Borrego, who's
really
recovering.
He took that whole prison thing pretty seriously, didn't he?
Yeah, really. Learned his lesson.
Yep, he did. And Buddy Clinton, dead at age, I don't think he was even 2, killed by a car.
Nice going, Bill. Way to take care of your animals.
So-called best pal, Bill
Clinton.
Help
or anything.
Yeah.
Somebody claimed was a loyal friend. Well, this loyal friend was hanging out at home all by himself while Bill hangs in Harlem.
Boy, they had a picture of Bill Clinton in the tabs over vacation.
He was sitting there
getting ready to kiss Joan Collins.
Did you see the cover of the Globe with Chelsea bombed off her ass?
They were supposedly
she's being helped out of a limo. Yeah, and she's like,
She and her dear old dad, I guess, were just swilling Kettle One at some event.
She's
a vodka
drinker.
Yeah. And this was an event where he lost his cell phone, had to send the Secret Service back into the restaurant to get it.
Well,
they're pouring out fists of Kettle One. Poor Buddy gets out of the house, runs around in heavy traffic on a busy road near the Clinton's Chapel home, and gets hit by a car. Most photographed dog in the United States. Dead.
Heads up!
Poor Buddy. Trudi Daniels with Rock and Roll Radio News.
All right. Well, it was good to be back. Tomorrow is Friday, so we're very happy to be back. Late juncture of the week. We'll have Gene Simmons and a therapist who farts to help people with their phobias.
That's just great.
I think it's great.
That's huge.
Fantastic. So hang on for Doug. We'll see you January 4, 2002. Leaving you with a gratuitous rock star. Thank you. Are you ready?
Ready.
Thank you, Detroit.
Coolness aside, I'd like to say thank you.
Thank you, Rudy.
Say it! Say it!
Thank you and stuff.
Thank you, Jesus!
Hey, you're beautiful,
media. Thank you, Detroit!
Hey, thank you, it's a beautiful thing.
Thank you, media.
Thank you, and God bless you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. We have to thank you for that.
Well, thank you very much, Drew and Mike.
Bye-bye! Bye-bye!
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you.
Thank you again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thanks for everything!
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Detroit!
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and God bless America. Bye.